It was one of Britain's proudest names, but now Rover's on the scrap heap, along with thousands of workers.
There is a sense of deep loss, of anger, of upset, of betrayal.
Rover's bosses, the Phoenix Four, inherited a massive dowry from previous owners and still led Rover to ruin.
They virtually burnt through the entire $1 billion that BMW had given them.
But the men in charge have handsomely rewarded themselves with pay and pension packages worth £40 million, while the workforce face the dole.
The Phoenix Four, they're multi-millionaires now, what they've made at this company. And we really are the peasants.
Tonight on The Money Programme, we investigate the disastrous mistakes which led to so much money being wasted in Rover's billion-pound blunder.
The end of the road for MG Rover. All efforts to save it end in failure.
At Longbridge Social Club in Birmingham, just opposite MG Rover's factory, car workers are facing up to the day's shock announcement.
We knew it was going down the hill, but we didn't think it'd go down this fast, and we didn't realise it was so bad, so much in debt, because nobody ever told us anything was going on.
Gordon Lane is being made redundant, along with 6,000 other Rover workers.
I feel like my heart's been took away from me. And I've been there nearly 29 years now. We're like a family down there. You know, we all look after each other. That's how it used to be. But now it's all gone.
I was laid off today. And for the first time in a long while, I saw men crying. And you only see that normally at a death. And I thought that was appropriate, really, the death of Rover.
Gordon hasn't been made redundant just yet. He's one of a handful being kept on to finish off the last cars at Longbridge.
We'll be putting the lights out and closing the gates, I think. And that's a sad time. And that's how I feel.
For many, MG Rover was far more than just a car company.
It's 1 o'clock, it's a Sunday afternoon, and you're with me, Carl Chin, live on BBC WM.
Looking forward to you being with me between now...
Carl Chin is a local historian who hosts a radio show in the city. His proud boast, he's a passionate Brummie.
Our region and our communities. Longbridge was and still is a symbol. It's the best known factory in the country, and it's a symbol of British and particularly West Midlands manufacturing prowess. And so for us, the loss of the jobs was also tied in with the loss of our symbol.
When, after 30 years of crisis, MG Rover finally went under, the administrators were called in to flog off the remaining assets. In addition to the 6,000 lost jobs at Longbridge, a further 20,000 are now at risk in suppliers and dealerships. At the heart of the storm, the Phoenix Four, the management who led Rover to disaster. They're headed by John Towers. He returned defeated from China after Shanghai Motor Company, SAIC, refused his plea for a rescue bid.
You know, we got that close to a position with SAIC.
MG Rover ended up on the scrap heap amidst a welter of allegations against the Phoenix Four. They'd burned through a £1 billion legacy from previous owners, while pocketing £40 million for themselves. The management, led by Towers, stand accused of greed and incompetence.
If he delivered a success story, he's entitled to not only what he got, but five times that. That's not the issue. The issue is he supervised not just failure, but very worrying failure involving thousands of people. And that, to me, means he should really just be looking at his own conscience.
The Phoenix Four, they're multi-millionaires now, what they've made at this company. And we really are the peasants. We've got to scrimp and scrape now, trying to pay bills, you know, mortgages, things like that. doubt for. They've got a lot to answer for, I think.
The Phoenix 4 took charge 5 years ago after previous owner BMW abandoned Rover and left the firm on the brink of extinction. Towers & Co promised that under their management, Rover would rise from the ashes. But was there ever any hope that a company whose best days were a dim and distant memory could really survive? Up until the 1960s, Rover stood for top-notch British quality. Good, solid, and upper middle class. But in the 70s, there was a change of image. Rover was now part of the nationalised British Leyland Company, embracing famous old names like Wolseley, MG and Austin. It was a time of industrial chaos, and BL was racked by repeated strikes. Professor Chris Brady has written a history of the shifting fortunes of Rover.
There was a brand issue around the whole image of what Rover stood for. So instead of it standing for these very sedate, relaxed, comfortable times, it actually stood for chaos and sort of militancy.
And car buyers were increasingly unimpressed with the quality of the company's cars.
To this day, nobody knows why the world needed an Austin Maxi. It really was the most appalling chunk of junk. BL tried desperately to raise its image by campaigning it in rallies, but perhaps the best thing you could say about it was that both front seats reclined to make a cosy double bed. Very handy for the hard shoulder.
In 1979, Mrs. Thatcher came to power in a Rover. She was determined to privatise the company. It was first taken over by British Aerospace. And then, in 1994, the German car giant BMW bought the company. Hailed as a salvation, in fact, it sowed the seeds of the crisis that would eventually engulf Rover. They invested £3 billion, pinning their hopes of success on a new model, the Rover 75.
Fantastic car, beautiful car, well engineered, well designed, and I thought we got a brilliant future.
But there was a problem. The 75 was too similar to BMW's own 3 Series, and Rover couldn't shake off its poor reputation.
The Rover 75 was actually a brilliant car, and won European Car of the Year when it came out. But given that the brand was tarnished, you need to ask yourself the question, am I going to pay £20,000 for a 3 Series or a Rover 75? The city boys wanted BMWs, they didn't want a Rover 75. So it was competing in the wrong market.
By 2000, because of their vast investment, the Germans were losing £750 million per year. They wanted out.
BMW poured all that money in and it didn't work. And it suggests that maybe it was a dead brand, because if BMW couldn't revive it, I mean, who could? I mean, they are the best.
BMW sold the successful Land Rover brand to Ford and kept a tight grip on the promising new Mini. But they were determined to dump Rover.
When BMW made it clear that they were going to pull out of MG Rover and Longbridge, there was a sense of shock. Not only were we faced with nearly 10,000 jobs at Longbridge going, but the knock-on effect in the suppliers, in the dealers, in the local shops would have been catastrophic.
It was 2000, a year before an expected general election. The government feared for its prospects in marginal seats around Longbridge. Ministers were concerned about mass job losses resulting from BMW's pullout.
BMW to Rover, for you, Tommy, car production is over.
The first serious buyer to come along was venture capitalist John Moulton. He wanted to salvage MG and ditch Rover, but that would only have saved 1,500 jobs. Neither government nor workforce were keen on Mr. Moulton.
I've loved at the heart of me to have got MG Sports Cars as a successful company again. That would have been really nice. I'd have felt I'd have achieved something solid. MG, that was still a strong brand. But Rover really had had it.
Mr. Moulton was not only in pole position, he'd reached an agreement with BMW to close most of our plants, to sack most of our people, and to leave just the MGB brand in the plant. And he's on record of saying it would have created maybe 1,500 jobs. At the time, we thought that was close to 650 jobs.
Some believe it would have been better if Rover had gone to the wall then, with John Moulton free to develop the MG business, but it wasn't to be. Tony Woodley and Carl Chin helped mobilise 80,000 people in a march through Birmingham to protest against mass job losses.
We knew that there was a chance to keep volume car production at Longbridge. That's what we were fighting for. We needed another group of business people who also believed that volume car production could be kept going at Longbridge.
John Towers led the consortium making the rival bid. He was in charge at Rover when it was owned by British Aerospace, but he left after BMW took over. Now, he was making a comeback. He was joined by Nick Stevenson, Peter Beale, and John Edwards, businessmen from the West Midlands. Together, they became known as the Phoenix Four. They promised to resume mass production at Longbridge with minimal loss of jobs and profits within 2 years. They were backed by the unions and enjoyed huge public support in Birmingham. But John Moulton didn't believe them.
We knew that there was no future in the main car business, which is a shame, but it was probably beyond economic repair. Fagpacket seemed to show you needed £3 or 4 billion to reconstruct the volume car business.
Britain is a huge market for BMW, and the company couldn't afford to alienate public opinion. So they were offering money to keep Longbridge alive, but not £3 or 4 billion. It was during these critical times that politicians intervened.
It was the government that brought John Towers and BMW together for the first time, face to face.
Moulton bowed out after BMW refused his cash demands. So in May 2000, John Towers returned in triumph to Longbridge. The company was renamed MG Rover. BMW left the Phoenix Four a dowry worth £1 billion.
It's an emotional day, but we've also got to make sure that the objective side of the whole matter gets emphasised. We have a huge amount of work to do to put this business back into balance.
Staff also believed they were witnessing a new dawn.
Well, I thought it was fantastic. He was drinking champagne, we were cheering, shaking his hand and everything. We thought we got a big future ahead of us. And I thought, I'll reach my 65th birthday and retire properly with a good pension.
But even then, some thought the celebrations were premature.
On the Saturday night following the triumphalism of the Phoenix takeover, I gave a speech just by coincidence in the council house in the centre of Birmingham. And in it I said, please do not think that this city has got out of jail. All you've done is buy time.
The Phoenix Four did the deal of the decade for themselves. They paid BMW a token £10 for the Rover Group. They then each put in £60,000 and took out loans for further investment, claiming this was a big risk. But some say their stake was tiny compared to BMW's cash dowry worth £500 million.
The idea that they were taking a risk, taking on a £500 million dowry, actually it's a risk I'd love to take. Somebody gives me a company worth £500 million just in cash, I'm going to say yes, thank you very much.
With unsold cars and other assets, the total value of the BMW dowry was boosted to around £1 billion. Although there were also considerable liabilities, Towers was optimistic about the way ahead.
John Towers just promised utopia to a certain extent. Let's keep everything going as it is.
But there were many, even then, who thought Rover was already heading towards disaster.
I can't think of an analyst at the time that thought it was a viable business proposition, with the exception of Stephen Byers. Now, one can only assume that actually he didn't look at the business case, he only looked at the political case.
Much was needed to be done, engineering new cars, for example. But among the first priorities of the Phoenix 4 was a bit of financial re-engineering. Under umbrella company Phoenix Venture Holdings, they split MG Rover into lots of different companies. Some were profitable, some were not. In total, there were 30 different firms. Peter Beale defended the controversial move.
We needed to quickly understand exactly what parts of the company were making losses, what parts of the companies were making profits, and get some real management focus on those issues.
There's no need to split the company out in order to just see who's making money, who's not making money. That's what divisions are for. So you have to ask the question, why did they do it? At face value, it seems they did it in order to protect profit in certain areas and give the losses to an area you knew were going under at some stage anyway.
The financial re-engineering continued in their second year. While massive losses from the car-making business mounted, the Phoenix 4 bought a major stake in Rover's profitable car leasing business and removed it from Phoenix Venture Holdings altogether. And in the most audacious move of the lot, they set up a £17 million pension fund for themselves. Along with salary and other rewards, it's estimated that they stand to benefit by around £10 million each, £40 million in total. When the details of their personal fortunes were made public in their annual accounts, there was uproar. Former allies felt betrayed.
To over-reward yourself in the manner and in the way in which the Phoenix 4 have done, over-rewarding themselves for failure, it's completely, in my view, inexcusable.
I don't think they should be doing that, because it's taking money out of our funds on the MG Rover side. We need that money to go into the pot to develop new models.
MG Rover certainly needed investment in new cars. The old models were becoming the object of ridicule. They tried re-engineering the Rover 75 and rebadging it as an MG. It was marketed as a high-performance sports model.
Really, it should have a wood-burning stove instead of a heater and mullioned windows and perhaps a thatched roof. Obviously, they didn't have enough cash to design their own engine, so they bought one from Ford. It's the 4.6-litre V8 from a Mustang, and it's a terrible engine. This is rubbish!
Suffering that sort of criticism, MG Rover's market share was shrinking dramatically. From 10% in the mid-90s, it was now heading towards a pitiful 3%. To get back on track, the Phoenix 4 needed to merge MG Rover with a bigger car company. They wanted another firm to fund vital new models.
The idea that it could survive without a partner injecting huge amounts of cash was a nonsense. Everybody knew that. So the trick was, how quickly do you get a partner?
The hunt was getting urgent. In their first year, PVH burnt through £252 million. The Phoenix 4 started by approaching Malaysian company Proton, but they were rebuffed. They then went to a Chinese company, China Brilliance, and they were rebuffed again. That didn't surprise John Moulton. He'd done his homework.
We actually went around to see if there were partners, because clearly you could make at least a better ending to the process if you were able to sell off some of the mass production. Nobody was interested. I mean, truly nobody was interested of anybody that mattered.
In their second year, they lost £187 million, running total £438 million. They were getting through that billion fast. Finally, a minor collaboration with the Indian company Tata produced the City Rover, a small car designed for nipping around. The reviews had a familiar ring.
You've got to give us a verdict. So, okay. Was it rubbish or was it truly dreadful?
That is the worst car I've driven on this programme.
In their third and fourth years, they lost another £172 million, running total £611 million. Things were now truly desperate for MG Rover. They started flogging assets like their spare parts business and the Longbridge site itself, which they had to lease back. By 2004, Towers & Co. were once again seeking salvation from China. In April, they began talks with Shanghai Automotive Industry Corporation, known as SIAC. They were hoping for yet another £1 billion dowry. But had they left it all too late? As the negotiations gathered pace, the losses were running at a staggering £25 million per month. In November, their accountants warned them of their perilous situation. Without the SIAC deal, MG Rover faced collapse.
So all of a sudden, there's even more pressure on Rover. So suddenly, you really need cash. And at this stage, after 5 years of looking for a partner, they would have done anything to get cash.
They were so desperate, in fact, they surrendered to SIAC what some say were the company's crown jewels. In return for £67 million, they signed away the right to make Rover engines and models, including the once-acclaimed 75. And that's what the Chinese wanted most. So why did Towers & Co. give away their best bargaining chip before clinching a deal to save Longbridge? Well, the spokesman's told us that they knew they were in danger of collapse. They were desperate to do a deal. They had to take the ultimate gamble. They've likened themselves to an army crossing a river. They would sacrifice anything to keep going in the hope of reaching the other side. Publicly, there was no hint of this desperation. John Towers explained to local news just how the deal would work.
It's very much a partnership. It's very much not even a merger. There'll be a 70-30 split. Chinese joint venture in China, and then there'll be a wholly owned business back here in the UK, which remains at Longbridge, which remains a UK business.
Towers may have been styling himself as a general, but could his battle plan really get the better of the Chinese? John Moulton thought he had no chance, not least because he was up against real soldiers.
The Chinese are not noted for being soft and gentle negotiators. I think quite a lot of the management there come from a military background.
The Chinese saw them coming?
I have no doubt that the Chinese saw them coming and look forward to it.
Meanwhile, firms supplying vital components were getting jittery about doing business with Rover. They'd heard that the government was shoring up the firm with tax concessions.
So this is the factory?
Yes.
And nobody wants to do business with a company which can't pay its bills.
What we did was actually put all of our products onto this car to actually demonstrate to Rover that we had the capability, the inventiveness.
Gary Seal runs Cobra Automotive, which makes car trim. He spent a fortune developing a new product to supply to Rover.
This is the products here.
These are the products, yeah. We've invested heavily, exactly as we've been told to, invest in R&D, invest in new products. We put those products in hard cash terms, we've invested £270,000.
In March, he received assurances from MG Rover and SIAC that the talks were progressing well, and on that basis, he expected to get his money back.
We had official notification from the MG Rover management that the deals with the SAIC Shanghai were at an advanced stage and everything would hopefully be concluded to a satisfactory end and to carry on supplying as usual.
Now's the correct time to write to you to jointly confirm that our discussions are progressing well.
The last few weeks, we were all looking forward to prosperous business, exciting future, money coming in, start of a life again.
By the end of March, government and unions had joined the push to get SIAC to sign on the dotted line. The British were claiming that a deal was only 20 minutes away.
There was a very, very strong belief at long last, and after much frustration, that deal was about to be signed. Government ministers were available to make a statement in the plant. There were cameras available, both in the plant and at the DTI, to make what would have been a stunning announcement for investment, for new models, and for a very long-term future for thousands and thousands of Rover workers and component workers.
But there's a big dispute about whether the two sides were really so near to a deal. Sources close to SIAC have told us that the basic financial agreement, known as the Heads of Terms, hadn't even been drawn up, and it had taken months of asking for the Chinese to see the Phoenix Falls accounts. When they finally saw them, they were shocked by what they'd read. The Phoenix Four dispute both these allegations. They claim that there were completed heads of terms, and they had shown the Chinese the accounts at a very early stage. Whatever the truth, the Chinese lost faith in the deal, and in April, they pulled out.
It's the end of the road for MG Rover. In the last few minutes, the government has announced that the company is to go into administration.
So why did the talks finally fail? Critics believe the Chinese had no interest in giving the Birmingham plant a long-term future.
Well, Longbridge is the smallest mass production car site, really, that's left standing in Europe. The workforce, whilst, you know, fully hearted and nobody argues about their level of effort or commitment or any of that, are not young and cheap. There wasn't much there that people wanted. Shanghai clearly wanted designs.
So what did the Phoenix Four actually achieve during their 5 years in charge? For some, it may have been worthwhile.
If you're looking at what Towers did for the region, he kept 6,000 people in work for 5 years at reasonable rates. He gave them time for the suppliers in the area to diversify and not to be so reliant on Rover.
But it came at a very considerable cost.
So over the 5 years, they virtually burnt through the entire $1 billion that BMW had given them.
The Phoenix Four may have left MG Rover penniless, but they won't walk away empty-handed. They can look forward to comfortable retirements on the millions they took from MG Rover and associated companies. Fellow bosses are scathing.
I find it appalling. You can supervise failure and put 6,500 people on the dole and take what everybody seems to be saying is about £40 million on the way through.
The Phoenix Four refused to give us an interview. They told us in a statement,
"We are proud to have sustained car making at Longbridge for well over twice as long as many experts predicted, and it was a tragedy that we failed when so near to securing long-term success for the company."
For Gordon Lane, it's his final day at Rover. He's spent the past month finishing off the few remaining cars in the plant. Now he's walking out of Longbridge for the last time, with bitter feelings towards his former bosses.
They're leaving this company with mega bucks in their pockets, and they got big swanky homes, which they haven't got really got back to work, have they, like some of us, which is a scary, you know, scary thing to look out to.
The administrators are struggling to salvage what they can from the wreckage. A buyer may be found for MG, but Rover, once proud flag-bearer of the British car industry, is beyond help. Next week, it makes a profit of more than £2 billion and takes one in every £8 spent in the shops. We investigate how Tesco have become such a supermarket superpower and ask if it's good for the British consumer.